Our analysis brought us to this point right here, where the computed kappa is equal to the dot product between x and y, except with this diagonal matrix thrown into the middle. Okay? What do we want to do? We want to show that the computed value is equal to the exact computation, which was a dot product, except with a slightly changed input. Now, we're going to see that we can take the error and throw it onto the input vector x, or we can take the error and we can throw it onto the input vector y. And finally, we can also come up with something that's known as a forward error, where we take the error and we throw it onto the actual result. We show by how much the computed result differs from the actual result that we were trying to compute. And each of these results ends up being useful in a different situation. Now, this first result we're going to label as result 1b. The b stands for backward error result, and this is result number 1. This is result number 2. And then finally, this is a forward result, so we'll call it result 1f. Okay, so the b will always mean that we are coming up with a backward error result. The f will always mean that we're talking about a forward error result. Okay, now, we're going to put some bounds on how large the error is. And we notice that absolute values come in here. Well, what does that even mean to have an absolute value of a vector? Well, we'll get to that, okay? So, let's focus on this result right here, because it's sort of the easiest one to work with. It's pretty obvious that we can take this and we can manipulate this into x transpose times the vector y plus sigma n times y, right? And then it's a matter of declaring this to be our vector delta y, and we're done. Now, we could then say, okay, well, let's use what we learned about norms to put some bounds on this. And the bound then would be that, for example, the 2 norm of this changed vector, remember we like to have this touch, is bounded by, well, it's equal to sigma n y in 2 norm. And that then is bounded by the 2 norm of this diagonal matrix, and remember that the diagonal matrix consisted of the values theta n through theta 2, and it was this first ones, there was these first order of magnitude terms that were bounded by the largest value, namely gamma sub n. So it's easy to argue that this is actually less than or equal to gamma sub n. And then of course we need to multiply that times the 2 norm of y here and the 2 norm of y here. Now, when we do our backward error analysis, we often like to do better than that. We often would like to know exactly what error can be attributed to what element in the vector, as opposed to lumping all of the elements together and talking about the norm of the vector. So for that reason, we introduce a new notation. Let's motivate that notation. If we now look at delta y more carefully by exposing its individual entries as well as the individual entries of sigma n and y, we get this right here. We get that the delta psi 0, delta psi 1, etc. is equal to this diagonal matrix times the entries of y we now exposed explicitly, and if we do a diagonal matrix times that vector, then we just get this vector right here where corresponding entries multiply each other. So what we notice now is that delta psi 0 in absolute value is just equal to the absolute value of theta n times the absolute value of psi 0. But we saw that theta n in absolute value was bounded by this magic number we created, gamma n. So we end up with gamma n times the absolute value of psi 0. We can then do the same thing for delta psi 1 and bound it by gamma n times the absolute value of psi 1. When we go on to the absolute value of delta psi 2, we end up with a gamma n minus 1 times the absolute value of psi 2. But we showed that that gamma n minus 1 itself is bounded by gamma n. And obviously we get exactly the same result when we go forward. Now, if we then create a new notation where, given a vector y, we define its absolute value to be the vector of absolute values, then we can very concisely take this observation, or correspondingly this observation right here, and say that delta y in absolute value, the vector of absolute value of absolute values, is bounded by gamma n times the absolute value of y. And this is what we now call an element-wise error result. And what does this mean? Well, it may not be quite obvious why this is important when we look at the dot product, but this very elegant result turns out to really help us when we look at more complicated operations, and in particular, the extension of the absolute value of a vector, namely the absolute value of a matrix, which will be the matrix of absolute values of its entries, will become really important as we analyze matrix vector multiplication first, then matrix-matrix multiplication, and eventually LU factorization.